Hello, my name is Jonathan Clark. Welcome to another video in my tutorial series about basic audio recording. In this video, this video is kind of a standalone video. It's another theory video. Now, the last couple of videos that I've done have mostly been theory. The ones before that were mostly hands-on practical aspects. This one is another theory video, and you don't necessarily have to watch the ones that I've done before in order to get the most out of this. Although it might be a little bit helpful if you've watched videos number 6 and 8 in this series. Now, basically, what I want to do today is talk to you about a couple things that I've touched on in the past, but in more depth. First, I want to talk about the Nyquist theorem, and then I want to talk about aliasing and how you can use anti-aliasing to solve the problem of aliasing. I'm going to talk about Dither. And then finally, I'm going to come back to sampling rates and sizes. Now, in a couple of the last videos, for instance, video number 6, I talked about the difference between 16 and 24-bit sampling. And I talked about how with 24-bit samples, you have a higher resolution of your sample, and that makes it better. Now, in general, that's actually correct. But then I went on in video number 8, and I kind of contradicted myself, because I said that in the digital domain, when you're looking at the differences between 16 and 24-bit, the top 16 of your 24 bits basically mirrors what happens in 16-bit, and so the only advantage that you get with 24-bit recording is that you have more space at the bottom, more dynamic range, you've got a lower noise floor to work with. So in that sense, is the playback quality of 16-bit sampled audio any different than 24-bit? Well, perhaps not. So I'm going to talk about those things in detail later in this video, and we'll figure out, you know, was I wrong in one of those videos? Was I right in both? Was I right in neither? We'll go into in more depth so you get a better understanding of exactly what I'm talking about. Okay, if you do want to go back and look at any of the past videos that I've done, you haven't seen them yet, go to djbolivia.ca/videos, and I've got a complete organized index on that site, so bookmark that, and you'll be able to find everything. Anyway, let's get to work. We'll start with the Nyquist theorem. What people refer to as the sampling theorem, the full name for it is the Nyquist-Shannon sampling theorem. Now, this theorem, it's named after a couple people that did a lot of research into audio back in the 1920s, 30s, 40s. Basically, Harry Nyquist is one of them. He was the one that was kind of the front runner in the naming, although many other people did research on the same subject in the same approximate time frames as him, maybe before even. The other person, Claude Shannon, it's interesting that that his name is attached to it. I'm kind of glad because it recognizes somebody who's had an enormous impact on all of us today. Because Claude Shannon, what he did was he did a lot of research. He's the one, he published his master's thesis about Boolean algebra. And this is something that hadn't really been talked about before. So I don't know if you could say he discovered it or invented it, but he certainly brought it to the attention of the world. And the reason that's important is because Boolean algebra allows us to use logic gates with binary. And essentially what this means is he laid the foundation, which makes it possible for computers to exist. So if nobody had ever discovered Boolean algebra or brought it to the attention of the rest of the world, then computers as we know it today couldn't exist. And that pretty much applies to any sort of electronic device that uses processors in it, not just computers. So anyway, sometimes shortened to just the sampling theorem, and sometimes shortened to just Nyquist. So I talked about this in a previous video. Now, before I talk about this more, I want to talk about Fletcher-Munson curves, because these are also important. Now, what I've done here is I've drawn out a curve, and here on the x-axis, I've got the typical hearing range for a good human, a you know, a human with excellent hearing. So we've got 0, 20 hertz. This would be the lowest notes that we can hear right here in general. Moving up, we have 500 hertz, 1,000 hertz, or 1 kilohertz. We have 5K, 10K, 20K, and most people can't hear beyond 20K. Now, you'll notice that these are not spaced out evenly. The numbers get higher more quickly as you move on. So from here to here, we have a difference of 20 hertz. But if we added 20 hertz to this point, 10,000, then we'd end up with 10,000 and 20 hertz, when you can see we're actually closer to 20,000. So why is this? This is because the frequency range, the best way to chart it, is to use a logarithmic scale. Same as amplitude of sounds. So basically what we're doing, I mean, you could stretch out your graph so all the measurements on the x-axis are evenly spaced, but it doesn't make sense, so we compress it this way. Now, the interesting thing about this, with music, when you're talking about pitch is based on the frequency, and if you want to go up one octave in pitch on an instrument of any kind, you double the frequency. So going from 20 hertz to 40 hertz would go up one octave. Up here, going from 10 kilohertz to 20 kilohertz, again, one octave, okay? Now looking at the y-axis of my chart, I've got it in decibels, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80. Of course, it can go up. Why are these numbers evenly spaced when these are exponentially spaced? Well, these actually are also exponentially spaced, and it's you don't notice it because decibels, the measurement decibels, brings that logarithm into the measuring system. If you had labeled this according to power, then, you know, it doesn't matter what we start with. We'll start with an arbitrary one, but it would be 10, 100, 1,000, 10,000, and so on. So you'd see that the numbers get higher faster as you go on both of the two axes. So here's our frequency response chart. And why is this important? Why am I explaining this to you? Well, two more researchers, Fletcher and Munson, they did a lot of tests many, many, many years ago, and they were trying to understand more about the characteristics of perceived loudness of different frequencies. So if you are listening to a couple different frequencies that are at the same volume, you'll perceive one of them possibly to be a different volume than the other. So why is this? Now, if the two frequencies are very close, you may not notice a difference, but if they're spread out pretty far, it's very common for you to notice a difference. So yeah, why is this? Well, it's the way the human ear works. If you were to, as an example, if you were sitting in front of an orchestra and you had a sound meter and you could determine the volumes of different instruments, let's say that you compared a flute to a trombone playing in a lower register. They could be playing at exactly the same volume according to your sound meter, but you would probably hear the flute as being a lot louder note than the trombone. And the reason for that is because, again, humans perceive different frequencies differently, but you can also look at this on a chart and try and understand where we perceive, what levels we perceive these different sounds at, depending on the frequency. Okay, now why would a human ever even perceive different sounds, different frequencies at different volumes? Well, it kind of goes back to evolution. As, you know, Darwin and selection of the species, the more successful organisms are more likely over time to survive and to, you know, to reproduce and have offspring that continue the species. Well, basically the humans that had the best hearing probably were more successful in life. They probably survived longer and they reproduced, and over time humans evolved better and better hearing. But better hearing doesn't necessarily mean hearing every frequency available equally well. It means hearing the frequencies that matter. And so when you look at a Fletcher-Munson curve, I'm going to try and draw one here. I've drawn a rough approximation here of a Fletcher-Munson curve chart. And basically what this means, all these lines here, is that if you look at any given line, all the different points on this line are equivalent approximate loudness levels for an average human. Okay, so if you go, let's take the red line, because the red line is our lowest, it's kind of on the low end of the hearing scale. Let's say that we start at 40 decibels and come across and we hit a point right here and we look down and who knows what that is. Maybe that's 50 hertz, okay? And then we follow this all the way over here and we go to the 10 kilohertz line and we look at this point and that's, let's say that's at 15 decibels, who knows? Okay, basically what this chart tells us is that if we're listening to a 50 hertz tone that is being played at 40 decibels, and then we want to play a 10 kilohertz tone and have it sound as loud to us as this note, then it has to be at 15 decibels. So basically you can see that something in this frequency range does not have to be as loud for us to hear it as something down here in these low ranges. And basically looking at the chart, you can see that the stuff that we hear the best, and by best I mean it can be at the lowest levels and we'll still hear it well, is kind of the stuff, you know, from down in this range. And what's in this range, from say just below 1,000 hertz to just above 5,000 hertz? Human speech. Okay, so our bodies have evolved, our ears have evolved, so that it's easiest for us to hear the frequencies of the human speech range. Of all the different sounds out there, our bodies are best at hearing the frequencies that are used for human speech. And that's good, because that's how we communicate. Now, as you get further and further away in both directions, you have to have louder and louder audio for us to perceive it equally. So in nature, what kind of sounds are down here around the 20 hertz level? Well, not a whole lot. Thunder. So thunder has to be pretty loud in order for us to hear it as well as human speech. Up here, same thing. What's at 20 kilohertz? Well, there's harmonics of all the other sounds, but other than that, I don't know, birds chirping. Some birds might have notes pretty high, probably not that high. So that frequency range is less important to humans. So Fletcher-Munson curves, I mean, you can look those up online, and but the key point to take away is that certain frequencies are more obvious, easier for us to hear than other frequencies. Now, why is this important in terms of the Nyquist theorem? Well, it's not entirely. Well, we'll come back to that. Let's talk about Nyquist in a different sense. What is Nyquist about? Well, the theorem says that in order for you to get a good reproduction of, an accurate reproduction of a sound, of an audio stream, then your sample rate in the digital realm has to be at least double the frequency. So I mentioned this in one of my earlier videos, video number six. And when you're talking about music, because music matters in all frequencies for humans, assuming that you've got, you know, different instruments playing, you want to capture harmonics. If your music is intended to capture sounds across the entire audible spectrum, then we have frequencies from the low end to the high end within that music. Now, if we have to have double the frequency in order to capture a good sound, well, what's going to be the most important one? Double the 20 kilohertz, double the high stuff, because anything that is double the high frequency naturally is already going to be more than double the stuff below it. So here's our level. We have to make sure that everything up to 20 kilohertz is covered by the Nyquist theorem. So the Nyquist theorem also kind of gives us the name of another specific frequency. The Nyquist frequency is the frequency which is half of the sampling rate. So if you're talking on CDs, CDs are sampled at 44.1 kilohertz, which means that the Nyquist frequency is equal to 22,050 hertz. If you're talking about DVD video, the audio on a DVD video is sampled at 48 kilohertz, which means that the Nyquist frequency on DVD video is 24 kilohertz. Okay, so looking at this chart again, why does the Nyquist theorem matter to sampling? Now I've drawn our chart again, and this time what I've got is I've got random audio, music, noise, whatever. And it doesn't really matter what the level is. Let's just say it's up there at a good level. And we know that the Nyquist frequency is half of our sample rate frequency. And we know that if we go past the Nyquist frequency, then that means our sample frequency is no longer double what our audio frequency is, in which case our signal is not good enough. So we don't want to go over the Nyquist frequency ever. So if we're talking about CDs and our Nyquist frequency is at 22.05 kilohertz, we don't want to cross past that level. Now we know that human hearing is good to 20 kilohertz, okay? So this is the upper range right here of our sense of hearing. And the reason we don't want to go over the Nyquist frequency is because you start getting audio artifacts. And I'll explain this more in a couple minutes once we get into aliasing. But basically, the thing is that we want to eliminate all the frequencies that are past this point, past our Nyquist frequency point. And in order to do that, we have to put a filter. A mastering engineer will put a filter on the audio, and it's basically, think of it as a high cut, because you want to cut out the high frequencies. And because we don't usually use the word cut, high cut is equal to low pass. So we're going to put a low pass filter on this audio, and if we have the threshold frequency at 20,000, why would we do that? Well, it's because everything below 20,000, we don't want to get filtered out. So we have the filter starting at 20,000. Now, if it has to roll off all of these frequencies, or filter out, I call it rolling off. All of those frequencies, by the time you get up to the Nyquist frequency on a CD, that means basically you're cutting stuff off on a slope like this. Okay? So the roll off past your threshold is very steep. Now, let me talk about roll off. Roll off is, you don't really talk about slopes, like in terms of like in the real world, if in geography, I would call a slope based on a number of degrees or a percentage. Like you say you've got a 45 degree slope or a 50% slope. Okay, that's not the way it works in audio. You can't describe it that way because your graphs are different all the time. What you have to do is describe it in terms of the number of decibels of roll-off per frequency range. And usually, when I say per frequency range, usually they use octave, okay? So basically, per octave, well, you've got an octave from 20, double to double the frequency, 20 to 40, okay? So this is one octave. Now, let's say that our sound started at 60, and so we've got 20, 40, 60, 80. Okay? If our roll-off per octave was 60 decibels, then that means from this point, by the time you go up one octave, which is to this point, if it's a 60 decibel per octave roll-off, that means that's how steep the roll-off is. If we have a 40 decibel per octave roll-off, then it's going to go down 40 decibels, so from 60 to 20 over that octave, which means the slope is like this. If we have a lower, say we've only got a 20 decibel per octave roll-off, then we're only going to drop from 60 to 40 for each octave. So we're going to go more like a slope like this. And of course it would keep going. Once you get another octave up to 80K, then you'd lose another 20 decibels. And then once you get up to 160K, it's gone. So these different slopes, this is our roll-off, and the roll-off level can usually be set in your audio editor when you're setting a low-pass filter. And you can see that based on what I've done, if these three examples here are typical roll-off curves, then you can see that with my threshold at 20K and my Nyquist frequency at 22.05K, then I have to have a very, very incredibly steep roll-off in order to filter out all the frequencies above 22.05 completely down to 0 decibels. Very, very steep. Okay? And that is steep. Now, so why is there an advantage to having a higher sample rate? Well, if my sample rate is at 24 kilohertz instead, because I'm working, so let's say that I'm now working with DVD video, which is sample rate of 48 kilohertz, so my Nyquist frequency changes to 24 kilohertz, okay? So because of that, the point at which everything has to be filtered out by has changed. Now, it's like this. So my roll-off curve does not have to be as steep in order for me to successfully remove all the audio above my threshold. So, why does this matter? Well, in the old days, 20 years ago, when all this was starting out, analog filters were used to filter out all this extra stuff that we're trying to get rid of. Now, that was kind of low-tech, and analog filters, they were difficult to build, and they were especially difficult and especially expensive if you had to have higher roll-offs. I mean, it was easy to come up with a low-pass filter that filtered out at a gradual slope, but it got really expensive to build a high-quality one that would do a steep, steep curve. So if you were working with limitations like that, then it's really advantageous to have a high sample rate, because you do not need to have a filter that's as capable in order to still make sure all your frequencies are filtered out by the time you pass the Nyquist frequency. In today's world, with digital processing, it's a lot easier to come up with filters in software that have algorithms that filter stuff out on a steep curve. So it doesn't really matter. So in today's world, if you've got a sample rate of 44.1 or 48 kilohertz, it's not nearly as difficult to filter out all the higher frequencies as it used to be years ago with physical equipment that used analog low-pass filters. So does that mean that today, by using digital technology, it's less important for us to have those higher sample rates? Well, yes. Let's think for a few minutes now about what people can hear. Somebody with good hearing can hear from, say, 20 hertz all the way up to 20 kilohertz. Now, what about other people that don't have perfect hearing? So that would include maybe DJs who have spent years DJing without hearing protection, which is retarded, by the way. It might include people that have spent years working out at the gym, listening to their iPod with earbuds in at loud volumes, and that's slowly destroying your hearing. It might include people who are getting old and whose hearing just naturally degrades over time. So some people have this range. Other people maybe have this range. Other people maybe have this range. Okay, so if you looked at a graph of the whole population and how well the population as a whole can hear, and say that we have 100% of the people up here, 50% of the people up here, none of the people down here, well, obviously, below 20 hertz, basically nobody can hear. Above 20 kilohertz, nobody can hear. Around the main range of human speech, pretty much everyone can hear. And as you connect the dots, basically we've got a bell curve for the population that determines what frequencies people can hear. Now, there's a lot of information in here which is useful when it comes to understanding file sizes with different types of audio and bit rates. Now, I talked earlier about the fact, well, I've talked many times about the fact that when you've got a WAV file, CD quality is referred to as, CDs are recorded with a file format called PCM WAV. And waves, 44,100 is the sample frequency, which means that many times per second a sample is taken. And you know that it's 16-bit sampling is the standard for CDs, which means that every one of those 44,100 samples has 16 bits in it, which means that every single second you have to have storage capacity for 705,600 bits. Okay, does that make sense? Should. That many bits in every sample that you take, and you do it that many times per second, so you have to have that many bits to hold all that information. Okay, but that's only for a single mono channel, and you know that CDs are stereo. So you have to multiply it by 2, which means that effectively CDs, you have to be able to store that many bits per second. So divide that by 1,000 and you get kilobits per second. This is a good number to know. If you're looking at uncompressed audio, so a WAV file on a computer or an AIFF file, then that's how much the data rate is for that file. For every second of file length, you have 1411.2 kilobits of data, 1,000 bits of data. So why is this important? Well, at the start, years and years ago, computers were a lot slower and storage was less versatile. There was less storage space on hard drives and stuff like that. So when people were trying to store music a decade ago or to transfer it over the internet, it was difficult because they didn't have fast internet transfer speeds. They didn't have huge hard drives. And so back then, listening to audio, they were thinking, this stuff is taking up too much space. We need to make our audio files smaller so it's easier to store them and easier to transfer them. So they came up with these different mathematical algorithms for compressing the size of audio files. And when audio became compressed, depending on which method they used of compressing it, that was translated into something called a codec, C-O-D-E-C. And codec stands for coding and decoding. And basically, what would happen is a normal, full-quality, uncompressed file, like a WAV at this, would have a codec applied to it, and it would be compressed into a smaller file. So when you see MP3s, that's the best example. MP3s, at their highest common quality today, are 320 kilobits. Oops. Kilobits per second. So when you look at this, you can actually compare it to WAV or AIFF, and all of a sudden it starts to make more sense. An MP3 at this bit rate, if it was encoded at a constant bit rate instead of variable, then for every second there's 320,000 bits of information compared to a WAV, which is about 4 times as much. So basically, an MP3 at 320 compresses an audio file into 1/4 of its former size. So how does it do this? Well, obviously, if it's throwing away information to make the file smaller, it's losing some of the information. So what are the best ways to do it? Well, what it could do is it could lower the sample rate. So instead of going 44/100, it could take 1/4 of those measurements. So it could go, say, 11,025 samples per second, still keep the 16-bit samples, and then the number that it would result in being would be more like around 350 kilobits per second. So that's one option. Now the drawback, if your sample rate is cut, you run into all kinds of other problems. So what's another option? Well, it could go with a lower bit depth. Now, in one video I talked about that means your resolution of your samples is lower, but then we went on to discover that in the digital domain, that's not really that applicable. The only thing that matters is you lose some of your dynamic range down at the bottom with a noise floor. So if you go with cutting your number of bits down to 8, then all of a sudden you're doing 44,100 times 8, and you've only got about 705 kilobits per second. Okay, so that doesn't really solve our problem either, because it's not a low enough number. So how did they do it? How did they get MP3s down to 320? And actually, it was even worse than that, for because at the start, it was common for MP3s to be at 128 kilobits per second instead of 1320. So back then, the average size of an MP3 was less than 10% of the size of a WAV file. Well, the codecs, depending on which codec you're using, whether it's MP3 or if it's one of several dozen other types, is they use a combination of a whole bunch of different methods. They might use some downsampling. Sorry, they may use some slower sample rates. They may use some reduced bit rates. But another thing they can do is eliminate bits in areas that people can't hear. So if you recognize that nobody can hear anything below 20 hertz, and very few people can hear below 50 or 60 hertz, well, what happens if you took everything from 50 or 60 and eliminated it completely, and you didn't include it in your compressed MP3? And what if at the same thing? A lot of people, especially older people, can't really hear much above 15 or 16,000 hertz. So what if you took everything above 15 or 16 up to 20 and eliminated it? Don't include it. Okay? So now you can see that we've started to eliminate some of the information that we need to store without really compromising the most important stuff, which we can hear the best. So that's how codecs work. And that's kind of a tangent away from the Nyquist theorem, but you know, that's a good thing for you to understand. Basically, when an MP3 is converted, or when a wave is converted to MP3 or to another compressed algorithm, then it doesn't usually compress all frequencies equally. They usually try to eliminate as much as possible of the very low frequencies or the very high frequencies that we don't really hear anyway. Now, I've been repeatedly saying that if your sample rate is not double your highest frequency in the audio, then you're not going to get good results, according to Nyquist. But I've never said why. I've kind of skirted around that issue. Why is it not good enough? Well, let's look at this chart I've drawn. And basically what I have, we'll go with a really simple wave. We'll go with a sine wave. Let's assume that we're using something not a broad scale audio sample. We're not listening to music that's got all kinds of different frequencies. We're listening to something, a tuning fork, something with a very single specific frequency. And it's a sine wave, and it's bouncing back and forth between its peaks at both parts of the cycle. Okay? And along the x-axis, we have the time in seconds. And so 0, 1 1,000th of a second, 2 1,000ths, 3 1,000ths, 4 1,000ths. So what's our frequency of this audio? Well, it's the time that it takes for the waveform to do one complete wave. Okay, so from here to here. Not to cross the zero point again, that's only half of a wave. Okay, so it's got to be going the same direction. Here, it's implied as going upwards. So here, it's going upwards. Okay, so our period, the amount of time it takes to do one complete wave, is 2/1,000ths of a second, which means that in a full second, it would be able to do that 500 times. So our frequency of this sine wave is 500 hertz. So the minimum sample rate, easy, double it. So in this example, we have to have at least a 1,000 hertz sample rate in order to get a good representation of this audio. Now, what happens if we don't? Let's say that we do a sample every... let's say that we're doing samples at 750 hertz, okay? So 750 hertz is roughly our samples are going to be located, starting here at time of zero. So we'll have sample, we'll have sample, we'll have sample. Does that work right? Work correctly? Sample, sample. Okay, these are in rough spots, but anyway. Now, so at those points, we know that we've got a dot here, we've got a dot here, we've got a dot here, we've got a dot here. So the problem is, if you've only got these red dots where we took samples, then we might assume that our waveform is going like this. Is that correct? No, because our waveform is this purple line. If you don't have enough samples, it means there are multiple solutions to the number of equations that could form possible, that could be possible equations that would give you these results. And you don't want multiple equations being able to give you the sample results, because then you don't know which equation it was, which means you don't know what your actual waveform pattern was. Once you get to more than double the sample rate, then, mathematically speaking, and I'm not going to try and prove this, you'll just have to trust me, mathematically speaking, once you get to that point, it's only possible for one equation to fulfill the requirements that give us that curve. So let's say that instead of a minimum sample rate of 1,000, let's say that we're doing samples at 1,500 hertz. So that's more than enough to meet our requirements here. So at 1,500 hertz, that means we are doing a sample every 0.0067 seconds. So we would have a sample. I'll do these below the line. We'll do a sample there. We'll do a sample there. We'll do one at 1350. We'll do one there. We'll do one at 0.00267. We'll do one at 0.00330 roughly. One at 4. Okay, so that's roughly where our samples are going to be. So our sample rate is faster, 1500. That means there's more of them. So instead of just 1, 2, 3, 4 dots, we are going to get, okay, that one's still good. I'll make it bigger. This one is going to be up here. This one is going to be down here. This one is good. This one is here. This one is here. This one is here. Okay, and then the ones, let's wipe out these ones so we're not confused. Okay. So basically, by going with a faster sample rate, if we try to interpret where the waveform is, you know, it's not going to be something that shoots up this way and then drops down this way. It doesn't, you know, the only possible way for it to pass through all these points is to go through a curve like this. Now, you might think, well, why can't it go up really shallow slope to hit that and then steep down to here and the same sort of thing? That's beyond the math here. You would have to understand a lot of calculus and other stuff to understand this. I mean, when you've got something using calculus, if you've studied calc, simple calc, maybe you know that on a curve, say you've got a random curve and you've got a single point, it's possible for you to find the slope of that point on the curve using calculus. You can't do that with simple geometry. Anyway, it's very complicated math, but you'll just have to understand that it works. That's how Nyquist works. It proves that you're going to get a perfectly accurate representation of the real waveform if your sample rate is more than double your frequency. Now, let's take this a little further, and let's get into aliasing. If you do not have a sample rate that is double your frequency, what happens? Well, you get problem frequencies, artifacts, fake frequencies. And it's interesting that it's possible to actually mathematically determine what the bad results are going to be with a very simple formula. And so the fake frequencies is equal to the sample rate minus the frequency. So basic, so simple. So let's say that we're going with CD 44.1, okay? So sample rate minus frequency equals problem. Now, our sample rate, I'll do five or six examples here. Our sample rate is going to be constant. We're listening to one CD. And for simplification here, I'm going to assume again that in each case we're going with a single frequency, a single note on a single simple instrument being played, not a whole range of frequencies. Let's say that we have some frequencies at 22, 24, 26, 28, 33, and 40. So, our sample rate is 44.1, which means that our Nyquist frequency is half that, which is 22.05. So, in order to get accurate results, we cannot have frequencies over 22.5 on a CD. So let's take a look at them. What have we got? Our first one is at 22 kilohertz. Is that a problem? Well, it's not even over the Nyquist frequency, so it doesn't matter. That's fine. It's not going to cause any problems, not going to cause any artifacts. The only thing that's notable about this is it's above the 20 kilohertz that we normally hear. By the way, these are all in kilohertz. All in thousands of hertz. It's above what we would be able to hear because it's above the 20 kilohertz kind of threshold, the top range of human hearing. Now, 44.1, let's say that our frequency is at 24. Is it over our Nyquist frequency? Yes, it is. So it's a problem. So what's the problem? Well, you subtract. 44.1 equals 24.0, minus 24.0 equals 20.1. And what's going to happen is you're going to get audio artifacts at this frequency. Now, is that a problem? No, actually that's not a problem either. We'll have artifacts in our audio, but they're above the frequency that we can hear. So once again, doesn't matter. Can't hear. Okay, so now let's say that we've got a tone at 26 kilohertz. So 44.1 minus 26.0 equals 18.1 kilohertz. Is that a problem? Yes. That's on the upper range of where we can hear, but some people will be able to hear that. So you're going to get basically an artifact or a small amount of distortion at that frequency if your audio contains stuff at 26. Okay, what about 44.1 subtract 28? Say our tone is getting higher and higher in pitch, now we're up to 28, then 16.1 kilohertz is our problem frequency. say we jump even more. We've got a tone at 33 kilohertz. We can't even hear it in the music. Let's say that we've just got an audio file, and the only thing that is playing in it is a single tone at 33 hertz. Well, we can't even hear that tone, so our audio should sound completely quiet, correct? Because that's above our range of hearing. Well, 44.1 subtract 33 equals 11.1 kilohertz, which means we're going to have a problem, because even though that file should sound quiet, we're going to hear a little bit of noise at the 11.1 kilohertz mark. Okay, and then the same thing with 44.1 subtract 40. So if we've got frequency at 40 kilohertz, which again we can't see, we're going to get a little bit of noise down in kind of the vocal range at 4.1 kilohertz. Okay, so these things, they're artifacts, they're unwanted problems in our audio, and this phenomena is called aliasing. And it's because the word alias, alias is a substitute, it's a pseudonym, it's a fake. Our fake frequency is our alias frequency. And so in our music, the frequencies above half our sampling rate, or above the Nyquist frequency, cause aliases. The aliases are at perfectly understandable and predictable frequencies by this really simple formula. So if you've got, let's take this one. If you've got an audio file which has a 33 kilohertz tone, which we can't hear, so it should sound like a quiet file to us, and because of our sample rate being at 44.1, there's an alias at 11.1, which we can hear. Is there a way to eliminate this? Well, there's actually two ways to eliminate it. The first is to filter this frequency out so it doesn't get through our audio. If that's not there, then our alias frequency is not there either. The second option is to filter out our alias, filter out this thing. If this is the problem, why don't we just get rid of that? Well, the problem is if we get rid of that, we're also getting rid of other frequencies in the music that we're trying to listen to or whatever. So eliminating the alias by itself is not an option. We have to eliminate the source. And the only easy way to eliminate the source is to use that high pass filter. Here's our graph, here's our frequency. Our low pass filter, high cut filter. And we filter out so that everything, if this is our 20 kilohertz and this is our 22 kilohertz, then everything above 22 gets filtered out. So that means that's not there, that's not there, that's not there, which means all of our problems, all of our alias problems are eliminated. So when you see a reference to anti-aliasing, it's so simple. All it is you're applying a filter, a high cut filter or a low pass filter, that is getting rid of all the unwanted frequencies that cause these aliases. That's it. Simple. Anti-aliasing is the application of a low pass filter. And it doesn't even apply in just audio. You can also have aliasing problems in graphics, like photos and stuff like that, and in video. And so they have the same thing. They do anti-aliasing in those fields, so not just audio. Okay, let's talk about dither. To understand dither, it helps to understand quantization noise first. Now, what's quantization noise? Quantity. Think about quantity. Quantity is a measurement. And a quantization error means an error in what you've measured. Okay? Here I've drawn a completely hypothetical, non-real-world situation. We've got a graph. Let's pretend that on this side of the graph we have frequencies, 31, 32 hertz. There's halfway between, 32 and a half. And it could go on forever. It goes way up and way down. but we're only interested in this rough range right now. And let's say that we have a signal that is playing constantly at exactly 31.3 hertz. That's the frequency. And so at any given point in time, as we go along and take samples, and it doesn't matter how often these samples are, let's say hypothetically it's a very, say we're doing 1,000 hertz for a sample rate, so 1,000 times per second. So these 10 samples will represent 1/100th of a second. Very quick. Okay, so over the course of the time, as we take these 10 samples, if we wanted to know the actual real-world value of our frequency at every time, we would take a measurement at every one of these ticks, and we would see, because we've got a perfect way of measuring, that every single time it's at 31.3. Okay, so in this example, our measurement system is so accurate that we have no quantization error. All the measurements that we take are accurate. There's no problem. Now, let's look at a hypothetical second situation similar to this, but in that one, for some reason, we can't measure anything except exact integer numbers. So no decimal points. So 31 we could measure, 32 we could measure. So it's possible to get a value at either of those, but not at any of these points in between. So how would you have a system like this? Well, let's say that we've got a binary system, and binary, you're not allowed to have decimal points. It's only even numbers of bits. So what happens in a binary system, if you're trying to make a measurement that falls between two different bits, two different values, the system has to figure out which value it assigns it to. Does it raise it to the next one above or lower it to the one below? Quite often it'll go to the closest one. Depends on the system. But no matter what, if you have to, if your measurement has to go to the nearest bit, or nearest integer in my example, then the difference between the real value and the value that it had to jump to, because it only fits into our measurement system, that difference is the measurement error. So in this system, if we assume that I can only measure exact full integers, so I can only go to 32 or 31, and let's assume in this particular system it always goes to the closest, then if I try to measure something at 31.3, the closest measurement, it's got to be one of these two. Well, this one is the closer. So in that case, my measurement would come in at 31 exactly, round number. And every time I take a measurement, it's going to do the same thing. So, by the way, my quantization error, QE, is the difference between the real value, 31.3, and the fake value, the one that we have to jump to. So our quantization error in this case is 0.3 hertz. It's how far we are off on this one sample from the real value. So if in this system our frequency is constant over time, and we keep taking samples constantly over time, every single time we try to measure this frequency, it always jumps to the closest whole number, which is always 31, which means, boom. So if we were to play this back afterwards, our frequency of 31.3 hertz would get played back as 31, because that's what all our samples are. Okay, so that's a problem. You can also look at the averages. Over these 10 samples, our average real frequency was 31.3, and that's just because it was always 31.3. Our average sample taken is 31.0. They're all the same. So our quantization error over the average of the 10 measurements, again, is the same thing. Quantization error equals 0.3 hertz. Now, is there a way to get a more accurate measurement using this system? Well, what if we can throw in some noise, some artificial noise? So what I'm going to do this time is we're going to go through and take our measurements again, but this time I'm going to add random noise, random data to our measurements. And does that make sense? Wouldn't that make things less accurate? If you've got an accurate number every time you measure and you add random information to it, that should make things worse, right? Well, yes, in theory, it should make things worse, but there are exceptions, and I'm going to show you an exception. Now, one thing I've done was I realized I put 32.5, so I fixed that. That's 31.5. Now, let's imagine you have a random number, and you take two steps. From that random number, you subtract 77, and then you add 77. What's your random number? Well, it's still the same thing, x. And you can do this over and over and over again, and you still get x. Now, what happens if you keep doing this over and over again, and you always subtract 77, but then you add back either 76 or 77 or 78? But each time you do it many, many times, and you do a third of the time for each one. So over the course of time, sometimes you're going to have x minus 1, sometimes you're going to have x, and sometimes you're going to have x plus 1. But on average, your number is not going to be changed. It's always going to be x. We're going to apply the same sort of principle here in just a second. And let me clarify one thing, too. When I said 31.3 is always going to be rounded down to 31 or 30 up to 32, it's not because we have a problem with our measurement instrumentation. Our instrumentation is good. It knows that it's 31.3. It's our storage of the information that's a problem. So it's the fact that we're working in binary, which doesn't have decimals, that's a problem. Or the fact that in this hypothetical example, I can only write down 31.0 or 32.0. You know, my measurement is accurate. It's the recording medium that's deficient. So what I'm going to do this time is I'm going to go through my 10 samples again, and every single time I'm going to subtract 0.45, and then I'm going to add back a random number, and I'm going to make sure that my random numbers on average even out to be 0.45, which means that by subtracting 0.45 and adding back 0.45 on average over time, my measurement should be unchanged. Okay, so how is this going to help us? Well, let's find out. I've got 10 numbers up here, and I'm going to use each of them once only to make sure that I've got a pseudo-random sample out of my 10 measurements that we're going to do. So each time I use one, I'll cross it off so I can't use it a second time. In the real world, that wouldn't happen. In the real world, it would be hopefully truly random. So you could have, for example, 0.7 could show up in three of these 10 samples, but over time, as you take thousands of samples, let's assume that these 10 different numbers do pop up with a random distribution, which means that by subtracting 0.45 and then adding back an average here, we are not giving any bias. On average, our measurement is going to be the same as it was before we did subtract 0.5, add random number. So let's give it a shot. Let's first of all realize that when you go 31.3 subtract 0.45, your number is 30.85. Okay, so that 30.85 is actually going to be the case after this step in all 10 of our numbers. So, for random numbers, let's start off with
0.2.
Okay, so 31.3, our real measurement, minus 0.45 equals 30.85, plus 0.2 gives us 31.05. And we have to round this number down to 31, or up to 32. So what are we going to do? Well, it's closest to 31, so that one is going to go right there. Okay, 0.2 is going to be plus 0.6. So that gives us 31.45. So 31.45 is our new measurement. That one was there. 31.45 is closer to 31 than to 32, so that one rounds down. 0.3, let's go 0.8. So we add 0.8, which gives us 31.65. So that would be right around here. And 31.65, is it closer to 31 or 32? Well, it's closer to 32. So this time we're going to go, our sample is there. Okay, 0.3. And that gives us 31.15. So there, which is there. 0.7. That gives us 30.55, which is right there, which rounds up to 32. 0.1. 95, which is actually even below our chart. It's right there, which means that rounds to this one. 0.0, so unchanged, 30.85. That's again a low number. That rounds to right there. 0.9, and so that becomes 31.75, which is pretty high. That's up there, so that rounds up. And 0.4 gives us 31.25, which is right there, so that rounds down to 31. And finally 0.5, which gives us 31.35, which rounds down to here. Okay, so the difference between the two systems, the first time, all 10 of our measurements, once they were rounded, brought us to 31 every time. So our average result over the 10 samples was 31. So let's see what this comes out to. We've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 of our measurements were 31. 1, 2, 3. 3 of our measurements were 32. Let's multiply these out. 217, 332s is 96, add them together, 313, divide 10, because that's how many samples we had, and our average sample is 31.3. That's amazing, because 31.3 is actually what that frequency was. So I've just shown you how sometimes by adding random errors into a set of calculations, into a measurement system, we can actually get better results in the end than if we had just gone with our initial system. Okay, so that was a hypothetical example of how the addition of noise to a measurement system can actually improve the accuracy of the measurements. Now, what else is noise good for? Well, let's look at a real-world example. Let's pretend we're on a golf course and it's a clear day, we're by a water trap, and the surface of that small pond is perfectly still. And say for some reason there's a bag of golf balls hanging above the water trap somewhere. And every second, a golf ball falls out of it and drops down and lands in the water. If you're standing on the bank looking out over this water trap, it's going to be extremely obvious where the golf balls are hitting, because they make a big splash. The ripples come outwards, and you can easily see the disturbance of those balls dropping into the water, because the water's been flat and clean otherwise. Now, what if you want to be able to use random noise to mask the problem? You don't like the fact that it's obvious to see where the golf balls are landing. So what you can do is imagine what happens when it rains. Rain means all these water drops are hitting the surface of the pond everywhere, randomly, and so the rain hitting the surface of the pond is the same as adding noise. And basically, with all those raindrops hitting the pond, there's distractions everywhere, and that makes it less obvious that you've got a problem, a disturbance, where the golf balls are hitting the water. So, essentially what I'm saying is that you can also use noise to mask a problem. Dither is the addition of random noise to a system to try and fix problems, solve problems, okay? Now in the digital signal processing world, digital realm, one of the drawbacks of everything is that when calculations are performed, they're based on math. They don't change. They're always doing the same thing over and over again. And it's possible, depending on the calculations, to be causing problems. And if they do cause a problem, it keeps doing it over and over again. Now, let's take a hypothetical example. And let's say that we are doing some sort of processing of a signal whereby the result that we're getting, it's taking a number, it's dividing it into one of three choices, 0.0, 1/3, 0.333, or 2/3, 0.6666. And it's adding those random numbers, those three numbers, to either 57 or 58. Okay? So our choices that are coming out of this system are 57, 57.333, 57.667, 58, 58.333, and 58.667. Okay, and let's also assume that for some reason this system is truncating data and hashed around to the nearest whole number again. So our 57.0 becomes a 57. Our 57.3 becomes another 57. Our 57.66 becomes a 58. Our 58.0 becomes a 58, stays 58. Our 58.3 becomes a 58. And our 58.66 becomes a, becomes a 59. Okay? So in this system, it's, I know, a weird hypothetical example, but you're getting skewed results because you should be getting even results somehow, and you're getting biased, weird numbers. Okay, in a more practical to audio explanation, instead of using some numbers, let's say that we have some sort of graph and our signal processing is causing a problem because we've got at some random frequency, let's say at 400 hertz, let's say our signal should be doing a result that looks kind of like this for some reason, and there's a problem in the processing so that we're getting noise, so we're getting a spike right there, a frequency spike at the 400 hertz level, and it's coming up several decibels, like maybe this stuff is around 70 decibels and this is around 80 decibels. Or actually, since we're working in the digital world, let's do it. Let's say that this is at minus 20, and this is peaking at minus 16. So we've got a 4 decibel spike there of stuff that we don't want. Okay? That's the sort of problem that we might be getting, and this is where Dither can come in different ways. Let's say that you want to eliminate this, and this is a very narrow, narrow spike. What if we did the same sort of thing where we, with the example earlier, we subtracted 0.45 and then we added a random number? All of these points down here would end up, instead of being, well, let's say that, even better, let's say that we have a very consistent volume of minus 20 decibels, except at the 400 hertz mark, we have a spike, Okay. If we add random noise into our system here, it may be that our numbers, our volumes, depending where we are randomly all over the place, a tiny bit below and a tiny bit above 20, but over time they average to 20. Our ear, because this is happening so quickly, this slight variation, our hearing interprets it as 20. But this thing, because we're doing some random numbers, instead of coming out as a peak like that, what it ends up being is just a bunch of numbers that are slightly above the average around it. Okay? So basically, adding dither to our system has somehow flattened and obliterated that problem spike in the frequency. Okay, so that's one sort of thing that might actually happen in real life. Dithering can also be used. Let's assume that you have a bunch of measurements. You know that our lowest bit in a 16-bit system, in any system, let's say we're down at the at a very, very low level. We're down here at negative 96 decibels. So we're at the very lowest possible measurement that we can measure in our 16-bit digital system. And let's say that the measurement is so low that instead of a measurement of, well, let's say that the that whatever we're trying to measure between the 0, 0 measurement and the 0, 0, 0, 1 measurement, you know, there's a whole bunch of zeros in front here, but between the very two possible bottom measurements, let's say that our value we're measuring falls at 1/3 of the way. So if there was such thing as binary with decimal points, then our number is actually 0.333 represented in binary. If we have that would measure as not even existing, that would measure as straight zeros all the time if we just took straight measurements. But by using dither, we can actually make this jump out of the background noise. It's possible for noises that are recorded in 16-bit below, slightly below 96, to actually be brought out using mathematical algorithms with dither to bring them to the forefront of noise, which is pretty crazy that math can do that kind of thing. Anyway, so that's a couple of the values of dither. I mean, the real reason it's mostly used, when you're doing downsampling, your final product, you want it at CD quality, say. Your project is at 24-bit and 48 kilohertz, but you want to downsample to 16 and 44.1. When you're downsampling, your algorithm might typically produce some bad-sounding audio if nothing is done to it, but if you add dither to it, it might smooth out some of the problems. So if your downsampling is causing problems at a certain frequency, you're hearing faint artifacts, faint distortion, whatever, here and there, applying dither while you're doing your downsampling may quite often solve the problems. And there's a lot of different algorithms out there for applying dither. You'll see drop-down items. Usually if you're downsampling at the end, you'll see a drop-down menu that says apply dither and then what type. And there may be all kinds of things like triangular dither, etc., etc., etc. Okay, I'm not going to get into which types of dither are best. Your best thing to do is just, if you're downsampling, apply it. And if you can, apply whatever default comes up in the audio editor. Take a listen. If you hear things that sound weird that weren't in your higher bitrate original, try a different dither algorithm. That's about really all I can say about dithering. That's basically what it is. It's the addition of noise, and sometimes it can make problems go away. And we won't go any deeper into that today. So before I finish the video, let's come back briefly to the old argument about what's the best bitrate to use, what's the best sample frequency. Well, if we look at CD quality for sample frequency, 44.1, then we're covered in terms of the Nyquist theorem. We know that we are more than double the highest frequency that the normal human being can hear. And so we don't necessarily need to go any higher than 44.1 to have good quality audio. Now, is there an advantage to oversampling? Well, oversampling is the term for sampling at a faster rate than necessary. So if 44.1 covers us for what we can hear, then going at a higher rate like 48 or 96 is oversampling. Is there any point in that? There's a small advantage. Remember that between the peak of what you can hear in terms of frequency for audio and your sample rate, you've got what's called the transition band. And knowing that you have to apply a low-pass filter above your highest audible frequency to that transition band to filter stuff out, if you have a wider band because you're oversampling and you've got more room, that's definitely going to make it better, because it means your low-pass filter, it makes it easier for your low-pass filter to deal with filtering everything out. Now, in terms of the bit rate, 16 versus 32, what's better? Well, it's a little bit more obvious here. 16 is, once it comes back to playback, your final product, then I would say unquestionably 16-bit is good enough. But while you're doing signal processing, I think there are certain advantages to being at 24. Now, we talked about the fact that both of those two bit rates have the same sort of resolution in the frequencies where most of your noise is recorded. So there's no real advantage there. But when you look at the lower noise floor and higher dynamic range that you get with 24-bit, there's some advantages. Because with that lower noise floor, let's say you're processing your signal frequently with effects, all sorts of stuff. Errors can kind of start to creep in, and noise from that low noise floor eventually can start kind of bubbling up into your more audible ranges. And so if you start out with 24-bit, that noise floor starts out so much lower that it's much less likely for noise to become a problem after repeated processing. Is that a big factor in home studio use? No, probably not. In a professional studio where stuff is getting processed so heavily, so many different things are happening, then yes, maybe that's more appropriate. But there's one other advantage too, and that is when you're recording a signal, you're generally trying to target a very perfect range. You don't want your signal to be recorded at too high a level, because there's the risk, if it suddenly gets too loud, that you'll go over, you'll cross the zero decibel line, and you'll temporarily get distortion or digital clipping, digital distortion. So because of that, usually you want to have your audio recorded down a little bit. When you start lowering the level that you record the audio at, you're more likely to get problems with your noise floor. And that's where 24-bit recording has a big advantage over 16, because that increased dynamic range means you can lower your record levels, give yourself lots more headroom, and you still don't have to necessarily worry about that noise floor because it's so much further below. So instead of targeting things so your microphone feeds and your instrument feeds are coming in with peaks at maybe 3 or 4 decibels below the zero decibel point, with 24-bit recording, you can keep them down quite low, like down around the minus 12, minus 15 mark, and it's okay. You've got all that headroom in case you get a spike or a transient in your audio. And yet, when you raise that later with your digital editor, you don't have to worry about that noise floor coming up also and causing problems because it's already so low. So in that sense, I would have to say that you still have an advantage of going with 24-bit recording over 16. You probably have a small advantage of going with 48 or 96 over 44.1, although I don't necessarily know that it's worth it to go all the way up to 96. In the end, for your final product, I don't think you're going to see a difference by downsampling to 16 and 44.1 and applying dithering when you're doing your downsampling, I don't think you could have a worse sounding product than if you actually, if your final audio was at 24-bit and 192 kilohertz as a sampling rate. I think your final product, 1644.1, is going to be just perfect, okay? That's my advice. Anyway, thank you for watching. No more theory videos for a little while. If I have time to make some more of these audio recording videos in the next couple weeks, it'll all be hands-on stuff. No matter what, worst case in the fall, I'll come back and I'll be doing a whole lot more videos. I've got another couple dozen in the series planned eventually. Like I say, if you want to look at some more, if you haven't seen them all, go to djbolivia.ca/videos. And of course, I've also got videos there about DJing and about music equipment, DJ equipment, all sorts of stuff. So check them out if you're interested. Thanks for watching. If you've got feedback, leave it on my Facebook fan page, facebook.com/djbolivia. And have a good night.